So the topic for today is sample collection in microbiology. So today we'll be discussing the different samples that we receive. What is the correct technique of collecting those samples? What is the correct way of collecting those samples? And the importance of the right technique. The right technique, the importance of the right technique of collection of those samples. So why is there need? Why is there any need of proper technique of collection of sample? Why cannot we just collect those samples in any which way we want to or in any random way? Why? Can anyone of you answer? Why cannot we collect, why there is a specific way to collect each sample? Why cannot we collect it the way we want it or we desire to collect or according to our convenience? Why is there a proper way to collect each sample? Because this whole, in the first, very first chapter, you studied about the universal presence of microbes. So in that chapter or in that practical class, you learned that there are this whole environment in which we live, it is inhabited with a number of microorganisms, millions and trillions of microorganisms. These microorganisms are present everywhere. Outside the body, inside our body, and on our body, on the surface of our body. These microorganisms are present everywhere. And most of these organisms, however, they are normal inhabiting normal commensal flora, but this normal commensal flora or those non-pathogenic organisms, they can also cause infections in specific persons or in specific conditions, like those persons whose immune status is compromised or whose immunity is lowered for that particular time period, then any microorganism or some microorganism that are non-pathogenic, they can also act as pathogens. So if you are suspecting a particular infection in a person and you are advising that test, so if you request a sample and if you do not obtain that sample correctly, so there are high chances that you can pick up the normal commensal flora also. And if you will be collecting different kinds of microorganisms, so your diagnosis will get confused. You will not be able to come to a conclusion that this particular organism, if you are able to isolate, suppose, five organisms or three organisms, so what happens? How can you be so sure that this particular organism is the pathogen and rest of the four are non-pathogen? So there is no way you can find out. So the best way is to collect the sample properly so that normal commensal flora is not picked up while collecting the specimen. While collecting the sample, only the pathogen gets picked up. So that is why the reason for this class is that most of you, when all of you complete your MBBS and you go for internship, what happens? You are the people who send these samples to the lab. And if you people won't be well versed about the correct technique of collecting the specimen, so what will happen? We'll be getting a number of samples where the pathogen will be missed and the normal commensal flora can be picked. So what happens, we won't be able to diagnose the etiology, we won't be able to confirm the etiological agent, and when the etiological agent will be wrong, so what happened, we'll put the wrong sensitivity panel and then the antibiotic prescribed will also be wrong. So that is why this particular class is very important, the correct way of collecting all the samples. So what are the samples that we receive in microbiology? Can you name some of the samples that we receive in microbiology? You can answer in the chat box. What are the samples that we receive in our lab? A number of samples are there. The most common sample that we receive is some of the samples you can enumerate. So, the most common specimen that we receive in our lab is urine sample, okay? So the correct way of collecting urine. Actually, what happens whenever the patient presents to you with fever of unknown origin or fever with chills and rigors, for that matter, even the patient does not complain of fever. The patient is there for his routine investigation. So what happens is this sample is advised most commonly. So the correct way or the correct sample for urine is known as midstream clean catch urine sample. Midstream clean catch urine sample. Just a minute. Okay, so the correct name of the urine sample that we the ideal urine sample is named as midstream clean catch urine sample. So the timing is also equally important. The urine sample that you request should be, you should tell the patient to collect the first voided morning sample. When the patient gets up in the morning, what happens, the first voided sample is to be collected. Why is there any reason for that? Yes, because overnight, what happens after the incubation in the bladder, the bacteria will get multiplied. So there will be higher chances of obtaining the pathogen here. So what do you advise the patient, or what do you explain the patient that he goes to bed and when he gets up in the morning, the first sample is to be collected. And if not possible, that if you have to collect the sample then and there only, so what you have to say, you have to tell the patient to at least wait for 4 hours after the last void. After the last void, the patient has to wait for 4 hours so that the count will get increased. If not that much, but still the count will get increased after 4 hours of incubation. So what happens, this is the timing, and after to explain the proper method of collection, explaining the timing you have collection, and that proper method of collection is that the patient has to thoroughly clean the external genitalia with soap and water. There should be that soap should not have any antiseptic. It should be normal soap, and the patient is asked to wash the external genitalia with soap and water. And then if you are explaining this to a male patient, you have to ask him to retract the prepuce and then collect the specimen in a universal container. The first picture I showed just here. The first picture that I showed just here is of a universal container. It is a sterile container with a wide mouth and a screw cap lid. So the patient has to, after washing the external genitalia, he has to retract the prepuce and then collect the, I just mentioned the name of this sample, midstream clean catch urine. So what he has to do, he has to let the first part of the urine pass, and then he has to collect the midstream sample, the second part of the urine. And after, there is labeling on that how much the urine should be collected. And after collecting that much urine, he has to pass the last part of the urine also in the, he has to pass off the last part of the urine. So the part of the urine that is to be collected is the midstream only. And if you are explaining it to a female, you have to ask the female to separate the labia with the two fingers and then pass off the first part of the urine and collect the second part of the urine in the universal container that I just showed. And after collecting sufficient amount of urine, the patient has to close the lid as soon as possible with minimal soiling of the outside of the container, and then pass off the third part of the urine. So this is the way that urine is to be collected. The first part of the urine is voided in the toilet bowl. The second part of the urine, that is known as the midstream urine, it is to be collected in the urine container or universal container. And the last part of the urine is again voided in the toilet bowl. So this particular sample is very important for you to know the proper timing and the proper method of collection. The timing is, the first urine in the morning is to be collected, and the second part of that urine is collected. The first part is voided in the urine in the toilet bowl, and the third part is also voided in the urine toilet bowl. Now, urine can also be collected by other ways also, and you can also collect the urine in from a from an indwelling catheter. If the patient is already catheterized, then you can collect the, although this specimen is not that much advisable, if you can collect the midstream, then that is preferred more. If the patient is already catheterized, then only you can collect the sample from the catheter. Otherwise, there are very high chances of collecting normal commensal or contaminants also. So what do you need to do? You have to clamp the upper portion of the port. Then you have to disinfect the portion of the catheter from which you have to withdraw the urine. And with the help of the syringe, you have to aspirate the urine and then clamp it back. Another way you can collect urine is by suprapubic collection. Suprapubic collection is the most ideal urine sample, but it is invasive, so there is no point in requesting invasive procedure for just a urine sample. So that is why this particular sample is not that much advised, but it is the most ideal one. It is basically reserved for infants or those adults who are not able to obtain a midstream, because it won't be easy for a child to understand and then collect this urine sample. So this suprapubic collection is reserved for only children or infants, and those adults who are facing difficulty in obtaining midstream clean catch urine. So what do you need to do? You have to tap on the upper part of the bladder and then disinfect the skin above the bladder, and then plunge a sterile needle with the syringe into the bladder and aspirate the urine and transfer it to a sterile container. Please note, because it is invasive, it is not advisable to request urine sample regularly. Then you can also collect this urine sample by cystoscopy, and cystoscopy is also not done routinely. So if a surgeon is already doing cystoscopy, he can collect urine from that cystoscope. So these are, because not easy to obtain, so that is why these are not routinely requested. The most requested sample is the midstream clean catch urine. Please try to remember this name, midstream clean catch urine. The urine sample collected is the first voided morning specimen. Why? Because inside the bladder, the bacteria are incubated and they get multiplied. And if it is not possible to collect the first morning specimen, you can wait for 4 hours after the last void and then collect the sample. The first part is voided in the solid bowl, second part is collected, and the third part is also flushed off. Then you can collect from indwelling catheter, not advisable because it is not advisable to actually catheterize the patient and collect the sample. Some people feel that it will help you obtain better specimen, but it is not advisable because it leads to high chances of UTI also, and it is also one of the samples that is very commonly contaminated. So if a patient is already catheterized, then you can collect. How will you collect? You will clamp above the port, then disinfect the portion from where you have to aspirate this urine. After disinfection, with the help of a sterile syringe, aspirate the urine and transfer it to a urine catheter. Suprapubic collection for children, for infants, or those people who cannot obtain midstream clean catch urine. Disinfect the area and with the help of a sterile needle, pierce and then aspirate the urine and put it in a sterile container. Now cystoscopy is not routinely done. If the surgeon is already doing cystoscopy, then you can obtain this sample. Then the next most common sample that we receive in our lab is pus. If you are collecting pus sample for superficial skin infection, then what is the thing that you need to know, and the thing that most of the people actually avoid or they are ignoring that they should do? That superficial skin infections should be irrigated with sterile normal saline or sterile distilled water before collecting the sample. Why? Because this irrigation or washing off will help in flushing off the commensal flora. So first you wash the area with normal saline or sterile distilled water, but it should not have any antiseptic. Why? Because the antiseptic will kill the pathogen and will give you false negative result. So what you need to do, you just flush off the area with normal saline or sterile distilled water. Then ideal is to aspirate the specimen with needle and syringe, and then transfer the sample in sterile vial and transport it to the lab as soon as possible. See, this is the first picture. The doctors are irrigating the area with normal saline, and after that they are trying to collect the sample. If it is a very shallow wound, then there's no need to collect the sample with sterile syringe. And if it is a deep wound, it is better to aspirate the sample with sterile syringe. If it is shallow wound, a simple swab can also do. So this is the proper method of collection of superficial skin infection. This is the one of the most common sample that we receive, but one of the most faulty samples that we receive, because most of the people, they do not know that they need to first flush off the area with normal saline to wash off the commensal flora. Now the another way is to collect by swabbing. Again, you have to clean the site with normal saline, sterile normal saline or sterile distilled water. Again, there should be no antiseptic. Why? Because the pathogen will be killed. After applying sterile saline, you have to moisten the swab head also with normal saline. Then pass the swab over the wound area using two techniques. One is Levine technique and the other is the Z-track technique. I'll be telling you later. And if you are not using any of the technique, then you can swab from center to edge also. Never from edge to centers, from center to edge only. Why? Because if you will start from edge to center, what will happen? There are high chances that you can pick up the normal commensal and then introduce the microorganism into the wound. Even if it is healing, it will get contaminated. Now, the swab should be pressed firmly enough, why? So that the fluid comes out from inside, so that it brings the pathogen out and that pathogen is further cultivated in our lab. So this is the Z-stroke technique. See, this is the Z-stroke technique. The swab is moved in a Z-like fashion. And this is the Levine technique. Surface swab of 1 centimeter of area, 1 centimeter square area in the wound, center to out leke jate, press into the wound to obtain fluid. You have to press it hard and deep so that the fluid is expressed and that fluid brings out the pathogen from inside to the swab, and from the swab it will be cultivated in our lab. And now deep seated wound, you have to clean the site with normal saline. Then you have to debride the area with cotton, alginate or rayon tipped swab. And these are the swabs that can be used in a normal routine lab, but these are the swabs that should not be used for molecular diagnosis. Why? Because they have some inhibitors that inhibit the PCR process actually. So these are the swabs that can be used for first swabbing. Now wound margins are gently separated with the fingers, and after separating the wound margin, what you have to do, you have to introduce the syringe or the swab and then aspirate if you are using a syringe, or you have to swab the area well and pick out the first swab, taking care not to touch the adjacent margins. You have to take the maximum precautions to minimize the risk of picking up of commensal flora actually. Now, collect from the active site. The active site will be visible to you on examination. Never from the necrotic or the healing site. Now, sample is transferred in a sterile vial and immediately transported to the lab. If you are suspecting that organism to be of anaerobic nature, then it should be transported in anaerobic transport vial and it should be promptly sent to the lab. Ideally, 2 samples should be taken. Now, from abscess, you have to clean the surface of the intact skin with 70% alcohol. Then you have to, for abscess, what you need to do, you have to withdraw the sample with the help of a needle and syringe. So after cleaning, you have to withdraw the sample with needle and syringe and then transfer it in a sterile vial and immediately transport it to the lab. See, this is the way to collect sample for abscess. first clean the area, then with the help of syringe and needle, withdraw the sample. Now, there are various body fluids that we receive in our lab, and those body fluids are pleural, pericardial fluid, peritoneal fluid, amniotic fluid, and synovial fluid. So, the ways to collect them is by percutaneous aspiration. Now, again, you have to take maximum care to avoid contamination with commensal flora, because all these samples will be obtained only by invasive procedure. You have to put in a syringe and then withdraw the sample. So these samples are actually very precious. You cannot routinely ask for pericardial fluid. You cannot routinely ask for pleural fluid. You cannot routinely ask for peritoneal or amniotic fluid, because all these procedures will be painful for the patient. So you have to take maximum care while obtaining these samples. Clean the puncture site with alcohol and then disinfect it with iodine solution. Now you can take tincture of iodine or povidone iodine, and after aseptic precaution, aspirate with the help of syringe and needle. So these are the pictures. The person is taking pericardial, the knee joint, and the person is taking synovial fluid from the distance. The picture showing a person is taking amniotic bone specimens. We also receive bone specimens in our lab, and bone specimens, you cannot just take a bone and take the sample. They are actually obtained while performing surgery or only by percutaneous biopsy. And then taken with maximum precaution. Maximum precautions should be taken to obtain this sample also, and then they are discharged in sterile containers and then sent to the lab as soon as possible. So these are pictures of bone chips that were taken during the surgery. Now we also receive tissue specimens. Tissue specimens can be from any of the tissue. Tissue biopsy samples should be collected from areas within and adjacent to the area of infection. Why? Because the microorganism can invade as well as spread to the area, and large enough tissue, 3 to 4 mm biopsy samples, small amount of sterile non-bacteriostatic saline may be added to keep the specimen moist. Why? Because if it will be dry, what will happen? The organism may die out. So normal bacteriostatic saline is provided to keep them alive, but it should be non-bacteriostatic. Why? Because the organism should not die, actually. It should be viable when it is received them. So 3 to 4 mm biopsy samples are taken, put in to the lab as soon as possible. See normal bacteriostatic saline and transported into the tissue specimen obtained in a universal container. So this container is known as the universal container, actually. If you it is a muscle tissue, there are high chances that the organism can be anaerobic, because Clostridium perfringens, it can cause gangrene, it can cause myositis, it can cause fasciitis. So all these tissues, they can be collected, and there are high chances that the organism is anaerobic here. So a separate piece of tissue should be discharged in a sterile tube containing anaerobic medium, and that anaerobic medium is RCM, Robertson Cooked medium, so that if you, the organism is actually, the idea is to cultivate them both ways, aerobically and anaerobically. If the organism will be aerobic, it will grow from the anaerobic container, and if the organism is anaerobic, so that the proper environment is provided for the microorganism to sustain itself and then to be cultured in the lab. Because if you will take the sample only aerobically, the anaerobic organism will die in the presence of oxygen. So ideally, both the samples should be sent. Small amount of tissue can be placed in a loosely capped wide mouth plastic cube, and that plastic cube is then sealed in it. Actually, what happens, anaerobic pouch systems are also available. Not only in RCM, you can also send the sample in pouch systems. These pouch systems are anaerobic. You can discharge the sample in a container. It should be loosely capped, and that particular container is put in an anaerobic pouch system. And you can also directly plate the sample also, and that culture plate is then put in an anaerobic pouch system. So these are the pictures. This is the picture of RCM, Robertson Cook medium. All these medium have already been explained to you in your previous class. And this is the anaerobic pouch system. What happened? There is a sachet here. That sachet has catalyst, and that sachet actually, what does it do? Is out the reaction so that all the oxygen is captured. What does it do? It's consumed, and the proper anaerobic environment is maintained in this particular pouch. And if you are suspecting the patient of infective endocarditis, so in the previous SGD, you were told that you can also cultivate the organism from the vegetation also. So a portion of the wall and the vegetation is taken, and then it is cultured. For all these samples, actually swab is the least advisable or least preferred sample. Why? Because there are high chances of picking up the normal flora or contaminants. So swabs should only be collected when tissue or respirate cannot be obtained. So you have to remove the debris by irrigation and cleaning with non-bacteriostatic sterile saline. And if wound is dry, you have to collect with moistened swab. Gently roll the swab off the surface of the wound 4 or 5 times, and it should be placed hard so that the fluid is expressed and you are able to take the pathogen. From eye also we receive samples. So if you are the patient is complaining of conjunctivitis, so what is done? A swab is taken, and that swab is rolled in the conjunctiva and then transported in the appropriate transport medium. If you are suspecting the patient to be of keratitis, then this swab does not help. Actually, scrapings are taken from the cornea, and these scrapings are taken with the help of a platinum spatula. And that platinum spatula should be sterile or heat sterilized. And this is the way. And actually, what is done? The clinician himself takes this sample and directly inoculates them on the culture medium. See, this is this way of taking sample. For endophthalmitis, again, the specimen should be collected surgically. So the surgeon collects these samples himself. So first picture, proper way of collection of sample from conjunctiva. The second picture, proper way of collection from cornea. Platinum spatula is taken and scrapings are taken for keratitis. Lid, for a lid infection, again, you can take the sample on a swab. And if you are taking sample for canaliculitis, material from the lacrimal gland should be transported anaerobically, because the most of the pathogens that cause this lacrimal gland infection are anaerobic themselves. For sinusitis associated with orbital cellulitis, maxillary sinus puncture is done by ENT surgeon. For ear swab, sample from the external ear is taken, and this external ear, it is also inhabited with a number of microorganisms. So what you need to do, just like in wound, you have to irrigate or wash the area, and you have to wash the area with a mild germicide, 1:2000 aqueous solution of benzyl chromium chloride. Why? To reduce the number of contaminating skin flora. And then this is the way. After irrigation, if the sample is taken with the sterile swab, sample from middle ear, ENT surgeon himself takes the sample after spontaneous perforation of the eardrum and by needle aspiration. He perforates the eardrum, enters the middle ear, and then takes the sample. And in all these samples, you have to take maximum care not to touch the adjacent areas, because all these samples, there are high chances of for them to be contaminated. Then sample from mastoid should be taken and swabbed during surgery, and actually the bone itself is the preferred most specimen for mastoiditis. Sputum is also one of the most common sample that we receive. Early morning specimen, again here, just like in urine, we prefer an early morning specimen. After a bout of cough, the patient is asked to, you need to listen this class actually very carefully, because you will be the, you are the people who will be explaining the proper way of collection of samples to your patients. So after sputum sample is also collected, is also taken early morning. You have to instruct the patient to brush his teeth, gargle with water immediately before obtaining the sputum specimen. Why? Because our oral cavity, it also has a number of microorganisms. So you have to avoid those microorganisms, and you have to by anyhow pick up the pathogen. So this brushing and gargling of mouth will help in flushing of the normal commensal flora. Then with, after taking the deep cup, you have to collect the sample in a sterile screw cap cup. So this is the way of collecting the sample. And while collecting the sample, to prevent there's another way in which you can collect the sample directly throwing the sputum or spitting the sputum out into the container. You can hold the container under the lower lip to catch the entire expurated cuff sample, and you have to take a tightly screw cap the container, and if any spilled material is on outside, you have to advise the patient to clean it with a moistened disinfectant. Your tissue, you have to take a tissue, moisten it with disinfectant, and clean the outer side of the container with maximum care not to let the disinfectant enter the container. So this is the way: early morning specimen, after brushing your teeth, gargling with water, then spitting off the or collecting the sample in the sterile container. Then you can also hold the container under the lower lip, tightly screw the container, and if there is any spilled material on the outside, clean the container. Throat swab is another respiratory sample that we take is throat swab. The patient is instructed to tilt the head back and breathe deeply. This sample is collected by the sputum sample. The patient can collect himself, but throat swab is collected by the clinician. So the patient is instructed to sit down, tilt the head back, and take breath deeply. And then the patient is asked to open the mouth wide and say this word "ah," so that the things are more visible to you. Then the tongue is gently depressed with a tongue blade, and swab is guided over the tongue into the posterior pharynx, taking care not to touch the tongue, not to touch the lips, not to touch the underside of the cheeks. The mucosa behind the uvula and the tonsillar pillar is only swabbed. None of the area other than the uvula or tonsillar pillar is swabbed, and this is swabbed in a sweeping motion. Care should be taken not to touch the lateral walls of the buccal cavity or the tongue. So, what is the right way of collection of throat swab? Patient is asked to sit down, tilt his head back, breathe deeply, say this word "ah," and then with the help of a tongue depressor, depress the tongue, roll the swab, and touch only uvula and tonsillar pillars. Tonsillar pillars, sweep karte hue jaoge, uvula tak jaoge, after covering the uvula, reached onto the other side of the tonsillar pillar. See, this is the way. Ask the patient to open his mouth, say this word "ah," depress the tongue, and roll the swab from tonsillar pillar to uvula and then again to the tonsillar pillar. Another sample that we take is nasopharyngeal swab. Nasopharyngeal swab is taken on, use only synthetic fiber swabs with thin plastic or wire shafts. Do not use calcium alginate swabs. I told you in the initial class, tilt the patient's head back to 70 degrees and then gently, slowly insert a swab with a flexible shaft through the nostril parallel to the palate until resistance is encountered. Or you can also estimate the distance from ear to the nostril. When you will observe or when you will experience the resistance, that means you are in contact with the nasopharynx. Then you have to gently rub and roll the swab. And then after rubbing and rolling, you have to leave the swab a few seconds to absorb the secretions. This is the way you have to ask the patient to sit down, tilt his head back to 70 degrees, gently and slowly insert the swab parallel to the nostril, parallel to the palate through the nostril until resistance is experienced. Now slowly remove the swab after rolling, rubbing, and leaving for a few seconds. Slowly remove the swab while rotating. Specimens can be collected from both sides using the same swab. If a deviated septum or blockage is there, or there is difficulty in obtaining the specimen from nostril, use the same swab to obtain the specimen from the other nostril. But ideally, there should be sample should be from both the sides, and place the swab into the transport tube provided. So this is the way. Insert the tube. Head is tilted to 70 degrees. Swab is introduced from the nostril parallel to the palate until resistance is there. Resistance indicates you are already there in the nasopharynx. Roll, rub, and leave for a few seconds. Another nasal sample that you can take is nasal midturbinate specimen. You have to tilt the head back to 70 degrees, rotating the swab, insert the swab, and now the distance should be less than 1 inch, about 2 centimeters into the nostril, parallel to the palate. And not at the nasopharynx. In the same way, you have to roll, rub, and leave, withdraw the swab, and immediately put it in the sterile tube and transport. You can also take anterior nasal specimens. And anterior nasal specimens are, they are actually, the distance here should be 5 centimeters. See here, the distance up to 3/4 of an inch. This was about 2 centimeters. If you are even before that, then the sample will be anterior nasal specimen. Nasopharyngeal sample is up to the pharynx. Then nasal midturbinate specimen is taken up to the midturbinate only. About 2 centimeters of the swab is inserted. If even lesser portion of the swab is inserted, like 1 centimeter, 1.5 centimeter, you will be in the anterior nares. So when you are already in the anterior nerve, you have to rotate the swab at least for 4 times. Then leave it for 15 seconds approximately. Why leave it? Because you are actually the more you are out in the nasal cavity, there will be less chances to pick up the sample because our anterior nerves are also inhabited a number of microorganisms. So now you have to leave it for 15 seconds, and you should be sure that you have collected enough drainage. Now you have repeated in the other nostril. You can also take nasal wash. Nasal wash is done by attaching the catheter to the suction apparatus. Patient's head is tilted to 70 degree. Now you have to put in inst you have to instill 1 to 1.5 ml of normal saline. The tubing is inserted into the nostril parallel to the palate. Catheter should reach equal to the distance from the nostrils through the outer opening of the ear. Now, after putting in the normal saline, gently aspirate or suction and take the specimen and transport it in the sterile vial. You can also take in, we also receive endotracheal aspirate. Endotracheal aspirate is aspiration should be done using 12 French gauge. Suction catheter. The catheter should be introduced through the endotracheal tube for at least 30 centimeter. Now gently aspirate the fluid. First aspirate is discarded. The second aspirate should be collected actually. See, the first part of most of the specimen is actually discarded. It should be collected with a 22 inch or 12 French gauge suction catheter. Catheter is introduced for at least 30 centimeter, aspirate without instilling normal saline solution. Aspirate is discarded. Now you have to instill 5 ml of saline into the tube. Then second aspirate is collected, and should be transported to the lab as soon as possible and should be cultured within 1 hour of collection. Now, bronchoalveolar lavage is collected by putting in 120 ml of normal saline into the lung segment through the bronchoscope and then aspirate it and send it to the lab. See, through the bronchoscope, you have to instill 120 ml of normal saline and then take a portion of it and send it to the lab. Now, blood samples are collected by preparing the site. We also receive blood samples for serology, immunology, and even for blood culture. So the way of collecting them will be same. You have to prepare the site of the venipuncture, put on the gloves, then clean with 70% alcohol to remove dirt or oil. Now you have to scrub the venipuncture site gently, and you have to clean it from for an area of 4 to 5 cm from inside to outside. This is the way of disinfecting the site of the venipuncture from inside to outside using 70% of alcohol. After that, it dries out. What you have to do, you have to swab the area with povidone iodine in a similar manner that I just showed for 4 to 5 cm, then allow it to dry. Then instruct the patient to clench and unclench the fist, then perform phlebotomy and using a needle and syringe. Then release the tourniquet and withdraw the needle. Then apply the pressure on the site of the puncture and place a bandage over there. Now, blood culture is also received. We receive blood culture. The ratio, timing, and volume and sets are important. So the amount of blood we take. And then we can take in an adult is about 10 to 20 ml. Then you have to divide it into culture bottles. In pediatric patient, you can take 6 to 10 ml or 5 to 10 ml. Usually, a properly collected blood, paired blood sample should not repeated for up to 5 days. In the previous class, you were told that how many blood you have to take. At a time, you have to take 2 samples. And those 2 samples are said to be of 1 set. And both the samples should be from different venipuncture site. If you are taking 1 sample from the right side, the other should be from the learning. You have to take 2 to 3 blood sets at least 2 hours apart. And some books also say that the minimum time difference should be 1 hour at least. And in cases of infective endocarditis or PUO, if you are not able to come to a diagnosis even after 3 sets, you can also take up to 5 sets. Timing is also very important. It should be taken ideally just before or during the fever spike, because there are chances of obtaining the organism more here. Then you have to thoroughly mix the bottles to avoid clotting. See, there are conventional and automated blood culture bottles also. So, though automated blood culture bottles are color coded for all the different organisms and age group, pediatric age group has different color, adult age group has different color, aerobic, anaerobic, fastidious, all these bottles have different color coding. But we also have homemade blood culture bottles here. So, these blood culture bottles are known to be conventional blood culture bottles. Blood culture infection bottles actually have triptic soy broth or bile broth. They are actually dispensed in 50 ml. So when you are taking the sample, you are taking the sample in sets. Mind it, each set has 2 bottles. Each bottle should have sample from a different venipuncture site, and that when after. When you are discharge this when you are you are taking the sample, what you need to do, you have to maintain a ratio to obtain the right amount of blood in that blood culture bottle. So the ratio should be 1:5. If the sample is 100 ml, you have to take 10, or you have to take 10 or 20 ml of blood. Okay, 1:1 अगर 50 ml है तो आप कितना लोगे 1:5 करने के लिए? 1:5 करने के लिए कितना लोगे? 50 ml है अगर, 50 ml आपके में है, आप उसका रेशियो कितना मेंटेन करोगे 1:5 के लिए? 5 to 10 ml लोगे। After removing the craft paper, then you have to inoculate the blood culture bottles. Now CSF is also one of the samples that we receive in lab, and it's a very precious sample. You have to take maximum aseptic precautions. After donning everything, you have to disinfect the puncture site with antiseptic solution and alcohol in a manner identical to the phlebotomy skin preparation from inside to outside in a circular fashion. Then insert the needle with the stylet at the right interspace according to the age group of the patient or the kind of the patient you are dealing with. Then you have already reached in the subarachnoid space, remove the stylet and spinal fluid is. When the spinal fluid appears in the needle hub, you actually do one thing, you measure the pressure and then collect the sample in different 3 to 4 sterile labeled tubes. Why 3 to 4? Because CSF is one of the most precious sample, and when you are reaching the CNS space, so what will happen? There are maximum chances that you yourself can introduce the pathogen inside the body. So you cannot do it every now and then. So when you are taking, take it in such a way that you can investigate it properly for biochemistry, for bacteriology and for hematology also. So this is the way you collect the sample. In the first tube, you take the sample for biochemistry. The second tube, you take sample for microbiology. In the third tube, you take sample for hematology. And if you are having other tests on your mind, you can take the fourth tube for other tests. So this is the way of collecting CSF sample. Now there are few samples that we see in our lab for genital urinary tract infection. So cervical swab is also there that we receive. It is collected with the help of a speculum after removal of a cervical mucus with a large swab. Actually, what do? You introduce the speculum inside and then take a large swab and remove the cervical mucus. After the cervical mucus is removed, a smaller swab with a plastic shaft or a Dacron or polyester tape is recommended, taken and then introduced it inside and inserted for a few millimeters past the cervical loss. Rotate it firmly and then remove, taking care not to touch the lateral walls of the vaginal wall. So this is the way you take the sample, introduce the speculum with the help of the swab. You instill it up to the cervical loss, rotate it and then withdraw it, taking care not to touch on the adjacent sides, and then put the swab inside the sterile tube, screw cap it and send it to the lab. Vaginal, high vaginal swabs are also obtained here, so received there. So this high vaginal swab has very, very high chances of being contaminated with the normal vaginal microbiota. So this is one of the samples that is usually, that we receive is usually contaminated. So this sample is also to be addressed properly. Vaginal secretions can be aspirated or collected with the swab, taking care not to touch the adjacent areas. So this is the way you receive the vaginal swab. Now the last sample that we receive is last but not the least, one of the most common samples is stool. Small quantity of solid, semi-solid stool or 1/3 of the is taken in the 1/3 of the container. Actually, what happens here? Here also we take the universal container. In this universal container, solid and semi-solid stool is taken with the help of a spatula. Actually, with this universal container for stool, a spatula is provided. The spatula is there on the underside of the lid of the container. So with the help of that spatula, pick up the solid or semi-solid stool. If you are collecting watery stool, it should be collected 1 to 1/3 of the container. Rectal swab is usually not recommended because it is mostly contaminated and also not adequate for all the tests. And then all the samples, it should also be collected before starting of antibiotics. And when you are collecting the, explaining the patient to collect the sample, explain him to not to soil the outside of the container, because usually people do. Sample should never be collected from the bedpan. The sample has to be immediately transported on the lab. So this is a universal container for stool sample. See, there is a spatula on the underside of the lid of the on the underside of the lid. With the help of this spatula, solid and semi-solid stool is collected, and this watery stool can also be collected to 1/3 of it. So that is all for today. Most of the samples I tried to cover, and the samples that you need to remember are urine, blood, stool, and pus samples. ऐसे तो सारे आपको पता होने चाहिए, but these are the most common ones that we receive in our lab. पस में superficial से कैसे लेते हैं, deep से कैसे लेते हैं, abscess से कैसे लेते हैं. So so that is all for today. Quickly revising them. Urine mein kaun sa sample hota hai? Midstream clean catch urine. First part is discarded, second part is taken, last part is discarded. You can also take from indwelling catheter. Told you how to clean, how to clamp the port, how to clean it, and then how to take it with the syringe. Suprapubic for only infants and bedridden patients. Yeah, those patients who cannot take, and not actually bedridden patients, those who, patients who cannot give you midstream sample. And if you are also cannot take from catheter, cystoscopy, the surgeon takes the sample while performing cystoscopy. Never intentionally go for cystoscopy just to take urine sample. First sample हम लेते हैं superficial skin infection के लिए, clean करते हैं normal saline से पहले, फिर हम with the help of swab stick shallow wound से collect कर लेंगे, deep wound में हम with the help of a syringe. Swabbing के लिए मैंने आपको दो techniques बताई, Z stroke technique, technique बाहर से अंदर के. इसको भी हम पहले normal saline से distal water से wash off करते हैं, irrigate करते हैं. लेवाइंस टेक्निक से भी हम कर सकते हैं, 1 सेंटीमीटर स्क्वायर एरिया को क्लीन करेंगे, प्रेस करेंगे. डीप सीटेड वुंड से ले सकते हैं, इसको भी हम क्लीन करेंगे. Then abscess again clean करेंगे, 70% alcohol से aspirate करेंगे with the needle. Body fluid I told you percutaneous aspiration से करते हैं after cleaning with disinfectant. Iodine use कर सकते हैं, tincture iodine, povidone iodine, aspirate with the syringe. Some of the samples, body fluid samples are taken under USG guidance. Bone specimens during surgery by percutaneous biopsy, tissue specimens. Usually normal saline डाल करके रखते हैं so that it is moistened and the organism remains viable. Ideally take it in 2 containers. One should be anaerobic. Or you can also take the sample in anaerobic pouch. Infective endocarditis में vegetation itself is taken along with the blood culture. Eye में I told you about conjunctivitis, swab से लेंगे. Keratitis में spatula से, then ear swab after cleaning with benzalkonium fluoride, ear swab से लेंगे, then middle ear में the surgeon takes by puncturing the eardrum. Mastoiditis में actual bone लेते हैं, sputum is one of the very important samples, first specimen. After brushing and gargling the teeth, after brushing the teeth and gargling, take the sample in a sterile container. Throat swab, head tilted, mouth wide open, say the word ah, then with the help of tongue depressor, depress the tongue, roll the swab from tonsillar pillar to uvula to the other tonsillar pillar. Nasopharyngeal swab, again tilt it to 70 degree, insert the, there are suitable swabs for them that give maximum, minimum problem to the patient actually. So these are flexible mini tip swabs. They are introduced to the nostril, parallel to the palate until the resistance is experienced. roll, rub, leave for few seconds, and then remove without touching the other sides. Nasal turbinate specimen 70 degree तक tilt कराएंगे, less than 1 inch तक, until the resistance is met at the turbinate. Anterior nasal specimen, even lesser of the swab is introduced, about 1 to 1.5 centimeter, and rotated for at least 4 times and left for 15 seconds. Nasal wash again 70 degree. 1 to 1.5 ml of normal bacteriostatic saline is instilled and then suctioned. Endotracheal aspirate ka bhi, first part of the aspirate is discarded, then normal saline is instilled and then portion of it is transported to the lab. Bronchoalveolar wash mein bronchoscope se collect karte hain blood samples. I told you the way of antisepsis, then how to do venipuncture, then what should be the volume that should be taken, how many sets should be taken, then how many bottles are there in each set, and the site for each bottle, and the timing. I mean, during or just before the fever. CSF sample, and after antisepsis, take the sample in 3 tubes or 4 tubes. Minimum is 3 tubes for biochemistry, microbiology and hematology. Cervical swab with the speculum, with the help of speculum. Stool sample in universal container. Thank you so much. You can leave the house.